Hello, welcome. My name is Mary Lou Raboulis, Client Relations at CIM. On behalf of the Diversity and Inclusion Advisory Committee, we thank you for attending today's webinar. Before we get started, I'd like to begin by acknowledging that I'm on the traditional and unceded territory of the Kanien Heka Ha, a place which has long served as a site of meeting and exchange amongst nations. Most of us attending today are also on traditional unceded territory. Today's session is on equity, diversity, and inclusion data and objectives, the fourth of a series focusing on the new TSM protocols. And now, without further ado, I would like to present the moderator of today's session, Shirley Ngo, Manager, Environment, and Systems at Hudbay Minerals. Shirley is now in her 35th year of service with Hudbay Minerals and is currently the Manager Environmental Systems. Shirley's role has a strong focus on legal and other requirements, management system standards, and how to ensure that the company complies with these requirements. As the long-serving chair of the initiative leaders team responsible for the Mining Association of Canada's Towards Sustainable Mining Initiative, Shirley has helped to continually improve the TSM protocols and the ensuring site-level performance improvements at Hudbay. Welcome, Shirley.
Thank you very much, Mary Lou. Hello, everyone. I would also like to respectfully acknowledge that the land on which I join you from is the home of the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabe, the Chippewa, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat peoples, otherwise known as Toronto. As mentioned, today is the fourth session of a series on the new TSM protocols, and the objective of today's session is to deepen participant understanding of the TSM EDI and SHR, Safe, Healthy, Respectful Workplaces protocols, as well as their capacity to implement them. We will share practices regarding EDI and psychological safety, collecting demographic data, managing and sharing sensitive information. This session will focus on indicator 3 in the EDI workplace protocol. And so that all the participants are aware, a question and answer period will be allocated at the end of the session, but please type your questions in throughout the session as they occur, and we will address those during the Q&A at the end. So our first speaker today is Jackie Scales. Jackie Scales, a PhD, is a leader with over 15 years experience in equity, diversity, and inclusion, and over a decade of experience in the mining industry. As Director, Inclusion and Diversity at Tech Resources, Jackie is a change agent, leading initiatives that disrupt bias and drive employee engagement. Prior to Tech, she was a leader of Deloitte's EDI Human Capital and Consulting Practice, and has held board positions with community not-for-profit organizations. She is an active member of the Mining Industry Human Resources Council's Inclusion and Diversity Advisory Board. And last year, Jackie was honored as part of Women's Executive Network's top 100 in the executive leaders category. Over to you, Jackie.
Thanks. Thanks, Shirley. Hello, everyone. I want to acknowledge that we are sharing knowledge and learning together. And I join you from the Musqueam, Salesforth, and Squamish nations, and ask you all to acknowledge the lands that we get to learn together on today. So today we're going to talk about data and objectives for equitable, diverse, and inclusive workplaces. Next slide, please. There we go. So our approach to measuring EDI is really, there's sort of two. We have a monitoring, which is quantitative and ongoing. And then we have the qualitative, periodic, and then in addition to quantitative. So we look at some sample KPIs for us, because what I want to make sure everyone walks away from today, and I know the other panelists will have a similar message, is that it's not just in the data that you can collect, the quantitative data. You have to bring it together with your qualitative and your culture and how it informs the decisions you make as an organization. So when we look at some of our sample KPIs, we have a inclusive, respectful workplace policy that we rolled out across the organization. And so we look at, you know, training, and we look at number of participants in that, number of participants in our EDI foundational training, that we run for everyone across the organization. So our operational employees, as well as our corporate employees. We look at the number of performance objectives that are on people's annual scorecards, for example, going from our ELT, our executive leadership team, straight through the organization. Also, what number of facilities have we improved? So dries, change rooms, washrooms, creating a gender neutral space or universal space, looking at prayer rooms, nursing rooms, those types of things. And then we also have a number of ERGs, employee resource groups, and a number of committees that are run by employees. And so we look at that, and those are some of the KPIs. And so what are the outcomes and the impacts of those? We have an increase in reports of respectful workplace misconduct, which we expected to have now that we have been consistent in our language and our policy and our rollout and encouraging people to let us know when there's behaviors that don't align with our values. We can look at our EDI index score, look at diversity in headcount. And then we see the impact to having these KPIs. Our human rights risks decrease. We have a decrease, you'd have a decrease in voluntary turnover or absenteeism, and improving our brand as part of the ESG recognition that happens in our industry. And how do we listen? It's very important to listen. So we can collect data, we also need to listen. So monitoring and tracking the dashboard and leveraging passive data wherever we can. And also understanding different aspects of identity where possible and how that influences norms and behaviors within the culture. So we do things like a biannual survey. We have surveys for specific ERGs. We have event specific surveys to understand our employees' perspectives. We also do an annual gender pay equity review. Across the organization, across all roles. And so what's the impact to that? We have human rights risk assessments. So we run that. We also have in-depth respectful workplace audits across all of our sites and all of our corporate offices. And we also will have targeted interviews and focus groups depending on what the data is telling us so that we can get into it a little deeper. And so on the next slide, we talk, there's been some lessons as we've gone on this self-identification journey. And we, up until recently, have really only collected very little demographic data, which was a system limitation for us. We have changed our HRIS systems, so our information systems for human resources. And so now we're able to start collecting data. And these are some of the lessons we've learned. You need to start with why. Why are you collecting this data? It needs to, we need to balance the data needs with the authentic identification. So we know in the beginning, we're not going to get the identification because we have to build trust. What are we doing with the data? Why do we want the data? How is that going to impact people who are giving us the data? And we know that trust doesn't happen overnight. And really, like, yes, we say it's anonymous. We also know that, you know, things aren't always anonymous. And so you need to make sure your data storage is airtight. You need to make sure how you're collecting your data, how you're mining your data is in fact anonymous so that people will trust and you can build that confidence in what you're doing with the data. So where do we look for options to self-identify? In recruitment. So an option when applicants apply. We ask demographic information. We ask which pronouns they want to be addressed by in their interview process, that type of thing. When someone is onboarded, we have a self-ID prompt that's sent at the 3-month mark at the end of their probationary period. They can go in and update. We also remind people through employee resource groups, belonging communication campaigns to go in and self-identify and show some of the benefits to that. And some of them may be programmatic, some may be from a policy perspective, just helping build that trust and confidence. We have our survey. So we have an anonymous identification in our inclusion and engagement survey. So that sits outside of our HRIS system so that people can see there's different avenues in which we collect this data. And this is how it helps us inform our strategy of building an inclusive and respectful workplace. We also have our annual prompt around your HRIS profile. And in that we say, hey, if you want to update your demographic information, here's an opportunity to do that. And then we also look at development and departure data to see if there's anything from a demographic perspective that we need to address. And so the next slide talks about, you know, how do we look at this from a planning perspective? So if we look at Indigenous employment and how we plan for getting the data, excuse me, in tech, we have planning. So we look at area of influence and communities of interest maps, social baseline, impact assessments. We then work with our communities of interest to develop performance objectives and overall employment strategy. Is there anything that we have to do that is unique? And then we act. So we look at what is the governance? How do we make sure we're reviewing and holding folks to account on the data? What are the interventions that we need to consider based on our data at each point in the talent cycle? And then how are we listening? What is our listening? If you remember a couple slides earlier, we have an engagement listening strategy. And so how are we listening? Is it working? And what are we doing with what we're hearing? And then we have measures to hold ourselves accountable to that. And so we look at things like pre-recruitment activities, applications received from local Indigenous people, percentage that each reach in the various stages of the talent life cycle, of the recruiting life cycle. We look at tenure and turnover of local Indigenous employees. And we might look at it by category. We might look at it by department. We might look at it by region. So we're looking at it and trying to leverage as much from that the data is telling us as possible. We then look at the number of local Indigenous employees and local Indigenous employees that receive a tech-sponsored training or capacity building, leadership development, succession pipeline, performance management. So we're looking at it and saying, what is the data telling us? And is there anything we have to adjust in this? And then we also look at who's receiving promotions. What are the lateral moves? How are we building skills for our Indigenous employees in this example? And so we really go from planning to action to measure. And then it's, you know, that full cycle where we want to make sure that we tweak as we need to, depending on what we're hearing and what the data is telling us. So here's some examples for you. How do you measure leadership strategy and our goals at the end of the day at a corporate level? So we look at it and we say, we need to implement our strategy for equity, diversity, and inclusion at tech. That's from 20, we do a 2-year strategy. And so you might have performance indicators and you saw this earlier as well, around KPIs. So 100% of our leaders have a performance objective where they're held accountable for EDI and they have action plans within their group. We may say we have 85% of our staff participate in our foundational training, which is available to all employees. And then we see an improvement in our human rights review scores, which happen biannually at tech. What's the goal? In the second example, we have, as I mentioned, implementing our respectful workplace policy and gender-based violence and harassment protocol and standard. So we've created these three items to ensure we have an inclusive and respectful workplace. And so we implement that. As we implement it, we look at performance indicators. Do we have a reduction in cases of disrespectful conduct? Are 100% of our staff trained in respectful workplace? And then obviously in the biannual human rights review, do we see a better score at the end of the day? I have a few more examples for you on the next slide. So let's talk about it from an operational perspective. Often we, you know, it's as many of us are aware, it's easier at a corporate level to sometimes have KPIs. How do we look at it from an operational perspective? So we start with the general manager. So what is an example for a performance indicator on a scorecard for a general manager? And it's, you know, you see here, words on the slide are basically saying, you know, we will increase representation of underrepresented groups in the talent pool by X percent, right? So you have to do a little bit of homework around what is your trending data telling you historically, what has the percentage year over year been in growth of the different demographic groups? And so that's the goal for the general manager. And then we look at the superintendent and we say, what does that look like for you? I'm going to support the minimum requirement to strengthen the workforce. So I'm going to increase by X. Then it goes to the general supervisor, and the supervisor may have a KPI that says in their performance scorecard, I'll sponsor a minimum of 2 candidates for all roles in order to increase representation. And then you look at the crew supervisor, and the crew supervisor's indicator will say, meet with all my team members to better understand their career interests, to see if there's an opportunity to support moving people around or providing opportunities for training, that sort of thing. So this is an example of how you can take EDI data and have it as scorecard data for your leadership team in our facilities. So over to Dan, and I think Dan, I'm supposed to introduce you. And of course, I do not have the intro, so Shirley.
I got you.
Thanks.
Thank you so much, Jackie, for your presentation. And as mentioned, we'll come back to questions and answers at the end of the session. So for now, we are going to turn over to Dan Petrowski. Dan's the HR director at Oryx Geoscience, a great place to work certified mineral exploration consulting firm of 65 employees. Dan leads Oryx's HR, ESG, and DEI practices. Along with leading the HR function for 7 years, Dan has taken an active role advising equity-serving charities on DEI, research, and data collection and interpretation practices for the last 5 years. He specializes in engagement burnout strategic frameworks to promote and enable equitable outcomes, wellness, and overall success for all employees in the workplace. Take it away, Dan.
Thanks so much, Shirley. Really excited to be here. Thanks so much. Before we get started, I'd like to acknowledge being here in Toronto. We are on the traditional territory of many nations, including the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabeg, the Chippewa, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat peoples. And really excited to be here learning with all of you. I hope I can impart really expanding of your mind here and really discuss burnout as a jumping off point for some of you, hopefully to bring to your own organizations as another tool to be able to tackle diversity, equity, and inclusion efforts with. And I say it's not for the faint of heart. We will go through this and really understand these are going to be hard-hitting matters that we are going to be getting into, that you're going to be assessing, and it needs to be treated as such as well. So if I can ask you if we can go to the next slide, please. Thanks. So for those that may be relatively unfamiliar with burnout, I thought we could start off with a refresher. You know, what is workplace burnout? We hear a lot of it. I personally hear a lot of it as kind of a synonym for just being tired or chronically tired, but it is more than that. Back in 2019, the World Health Organization deemed workplace burnout as a psychological syndrome, which is temporary, brought on by chronic stress and characterized by 3 things: exhaustion, cynicism, and inefficacy in their work. So exhaustion, thinking of feelings of tiredness, energy depletion, you're just running on fumes. Cynicism, a little bit more ambiguous, but think of, you know, you're less enthusiastic, you don't really care what happens at work, you've dealt the significance that your work, you don't really see the point of actually giving any sort of effort or any care. And then the inefficacy is really the amount, sorry, the degree that you feel that you can accomplish things at work and get things done, or what I like to call the degree of hope that you actually have when you press forward at work. It does tend to target people facing barriers or drag in how they spend their energy in day to day. If you're thinking engagement, how do we energize people? Burnout is how are all those things that really deplete our energy faster than we'd ideally like to burn it. So in essence, burnout is a measure of work-life misalignment. It's really about what do we need as individuals, as professionals, and how is that relating to what the workplace is providing? What barriers are there that really kind of impede our energy and our energy expenditure? And that's going to vary from position to position, organization to organization, even from manager to manager. Burnout does disproportionately affect non-white, non-male demographics and is more common during particular life stages and ages. Again, as you can imagine, what are those particular barriers or what are the drags that people go through each day that may be unique to particular ages, to particular racial or gender cohorts? What are those things that can pop up at work, and where does work and life intersect that these barriers can get in the way of how we spend our energy? So the stat below is from 2019. I thought it'd be a nice food for thought looking at pre-pandemic. 23% in the US, this poll was taken by Gallup, the pollsters and engagement folks. They do great research. And so 2019, 23% felt burnt out often or always. This number is 31% amongst millennial and Gen Z. Go to 2024 here, it's at 26% for all American employees. So as you can imagine, this is going up higher as financial stresses start piling up. We're seeing a little bit more layoffs across industries. There's a lot more challenges that businesses are facing these days, as well as individuals, and it's showing in the numbers. And as you can imagine, these numbers are also going to be higher for your younger workforce, as well as newcomers towards Canada as well, that may not have the financial security that will allow them to not have to worry about that and how it intersects with work as well, along with all the other barriers that may see. So something to keep in mind as we go forward. Next slide. So really quickly, burnout, I should say, can be caused by and can be mitigated by many things that are outside the control of workplaces. Think of things like people's mental health coming into work, things like depression or anxiety or other mental health conditions or statuses, people's exercise habits, their coping mechanisms, how resilient they are, social relationships, how they recharge, their diet. So many things can affect whether or not we're burnt out from work. And so many things can mitigate and contribute to it at the same time. And so our goal here as professionals, as a workplace of measuring burnout for equity and inclusion purposes, is to really merely assess the level of burnout in your company, knowing that it's going to vary amongst your people no matter what. We want to know how much specifically is work contributing to it, to which employee group, and whether we need to provide solutions to reduce workplace contributions to burnout in particular areas and take appropriate action. In addition to incorporating findings into organizational decisions, this allows us to adhere much better towards the National Psychological Safety Standard that's been rolled out a few years now, and allows us to be mindful as we make impactful organizational decisions. How is it going to impact people's mental health? Is it going to impact their burnout? Is it going to engage them? Some things that we want to keep in mind. And from there, we want to specifically monitor and adjust interventions over time to elicit constant improvement. Burnout, it takes time to address and also to understand what are the effect of certain interventions. And certainly, how does change in your organization affect burnout in your employees? And something that you'll have to monitor and bring back. We are a mineral exploration firm, so our work ranges and it varies from year to year depending on the market. In some cases, especially recently, some companies are facing layoffs. How is that going to be impacting the environment and the change in the environment, how it impacts your employees? Next slide. So going into how our measures work together, we'll go into really what does this actually look like? How does it work? What's the logic? And what do we need to know as we move forward using this? Next slide. So our measures, so something to take note on if you're really interested in implementing this into your organization. At Oryx, we use the Maslach Burnout Index General Survey. This is the gold standard as far as measuring burnout is concerned. It's the only measure I know of that I would ever use. There are a number of different versions of this one, but the manual found at mindgarden.com that is available for our purchase is very reasonable. It's not expensive at all. It's for general use and will be perfect for any organization with general positions that you're looking to assess. So why I really like this tool in particular, it is the only peer-reviewed validated tool to assess burnout indicators that's available. Burnout, as defined by this measure, can lead to depression and anxiety or be exacerbated by it. It's the only measure as well, as far as burnout goes, that has been validated to be a separate concept from depression or anxiety. Other lower quality measures of burnout cannot be entirely distinguished from anxiety or depression, but the Maslach Burnout Index does. And that's something to be mindful of because really you don't want to go around saying, hey, we're going to be assessing what are we doing? But when you're, what we're really doing is assessing people's depression or anxiety coming into work, which can get you into hot water, of course. So it's really important to be mindful what you are asking and what you are measuring and the potential impacts of that, both legally and certainly on a moral and ethical basis as well. Additionally, we utilize the Areas of Work-Life Companion Survey. This was created in tandem with the MBI survey, and this is to assess the environmental aspects that drive the burnout that's being assessed by the MBI. So the areas of work life is really what we're going to be really focusing on from a workplace perspective and workplace intervention perspective. We also use the engagement. I particularly use the Gallup Q12. I think there's a lot of great measures out there. A lot of them really circle a lot of the same issues around feedback, support, growth and development, caring, health and safety, really fundamental measures around essentially how people are managed. Why we use engagement and burnout, we'll get to in just the next slide, I think, actually. But ultimately, we want to know, hey, what are we doing to energize you? And what are we doing that's actively de-energizing you? And so it's going to be some tug and pull between the two elements, but we will ultimately want to reduce the drag. We want to maximize the energizing. And from there, we use the Gallup Q12. We also use the Employee Net Promoter Score. How likely you are to recommend your employer as a place to work. If there's a single question, it's a great benchmark. If you only have so much time, so much bandwidth to ask questions, to really indicate, are your people having a good experience, a neutral experience, or not a very good experience? And again, these are all publicly available if you're interested in learning more or knowing what these questions look like. Additionally, demographics, this is the important part, one of the important parts. Certainly, like Jackie had mentioned, having people self-select that information that they want to provide you is really crucial. And I'll get to a little bit in terms of how to go about communicating this a little bit more. But that demographic information allows us to really whittle down where are those issues, those problem areas and those inequities. Who is it happening to and what type of experience is it happening to? And allows you to start asking those questions for those cohorts as well and understand why is there perhaps a disparity between two groups in the first place as well and gives you a benchmark in which to improve. And then lastly, year-over-year changes. This is really the important part. You want to understand what impact do your interventions have year over year? Is it moving the dial forward for those target groups, or is it being ineffective, or is it getting worse? And then looking to understand the contributors behind that. Next slide. So really quickly, to really exemplify the dynamic between burnout and engagement, So they exist on the same continuum. Fun fact, engagement was actually born out of burnout research. That was really a thinking that, you know, if there's something that really drains our energy, there's something that has to energize us. And so really quickly, as you can imagine, the more that we can energize and engage our employees and provide that free flow of energy the way that they'd like, that's going to drive mental well-being. It's going to drive a supportive environment, significantly less health and safety incidences, higher productivity, higher quality of work, things that really drive career growth, that drive recognition that people want. And the more that you can support people, the way that they need to be supported from your diverse demographics, the better they are going to perform on the job and the more they are going to succeed. And ultimately that energy is going to be self-reinforcing because that energy is actually essentially becoming their reward. It's having them move in the way that they want. So something to also just keep in mind as well as when you move forward, what are we trying to do here for our people? Next slide. So the causal impact model. So this is really breaking down burnout and really how the factors fuel elements of burnout. So like I brought up before, it's three different distinct characteristics that really define total burnout. And we'll find when it's just one or the other, they are called different things and something to be mindful of as well, so that we're not overgeneralizing when we say we're burnt out or we're overextended. We really understand what these words mean and we can start normalizing them a little bit more as well. And so starting on the right side, the three areas of total burnout, you see exhaustion, cynicism, and inefficacy. Most commonly, it starts with exhaustion and cynicism, you know, that detachment from your role, that overworked feeling. And that because of all that, that's really starts leading into feeling ineffective because you just start doubting your work. You're too tired to really care. And at the end of the day, that's going to really take out how effective you really feel. And this is a snowballing effect. It can start in any one of these areas and start leaking into the other areas as well. But on the left side here, we have the areas of work life, control, workload, reward, community, fairness, and values. These are our areas of intervention along with engagement that help mitigate, that can help mitigate burnout, but it's also a measure of what might be contributing to it. For instance, you know, when you look at workload and exhaustion, ultimately higher the workload, the more exhausted your employees are going to be. And so what you want to look at are the job demands versus the resources available for that particular element. That's going to be that opportunity to mitigate and looking at what opportunities are there. And looking at other elements of this role here, you know, looking at control, it is a very key factor that is really at the top, the head of the river. It really allows for people to engage with work on terms that work for them. In some cases, I have the Dunning-Kruger effect referenced there. When you look at people's overconfidence when they start a role, when they look at the valley, when they realize how much they really have to learn and how much they really don't know about their role and that journey upwards, what is the level of control that's appropriate for their current experience? So something to be mindful of, how much control are you giving and how much do you want to give and how much flexibility and autonomy? And that allows them to better manage their workload for them because they may not be able to manage it for themselves because they may not be given the tools. So again, meeting them on their level and where they may be coming from. Some people may be more confident and comfortable and independent or further along. Some people may not. But again, at the end of the day, it's about understanding the individual in front of you and meeting them on their level in terms of how much control they have and growing with that. And so when we go into burnout and the areas of work life, really, we want to look at these values over time. You know, as reward improves, does that lower cynicism? As control and workload improve, is that lowering cynicism and exhaustion? And we will see that in the results, but those are the things we want to pay attention to. Next slide. So looking at a practical look, when you have, you've asked the questions, you've gotten the results, you've turned them into a numerical form, you've coded them appropriately. Essentially, what you want to do is profile your different cohorts or individuals as you see fit, depending on your bandwidth, be able to analyze them. But ultimately, there's five distinct burnout profiles. There's total burnout, where you have high cynicism, inefficacy, and exhaustion. The second is disengaged, where you're highly cynical. You know, you're alienated, you're detached, you're less enthused, you don't really find the significance of your work, but you're not really tired and you feel like you're effective enough. The third one is overextended. And this is the most common one I think people tend to tap into, is that you're tired at work. You just have too much going on, but you feel like you're effective, that your work matters and you're generally enjoying it. This is when you want to look at those job demand resources. And is this an appropriate balance for you, and going to your manager and looking for that? But there's also a good opportunity for managers to step in as well and see what supports may be there. Understanding some people may not want to say that they are overextended, but understanding that if they are showing the signs of it at least once a week, you should be stepping in, because those are clear-cut signs that someone is on the cusp of being overextended, or they are currently overextended if they are sighing or if they're staying late at least once a week to get their work done. Ineffective, that's the high inefficacy. They feel like they can't get their work done that they want to get done and having the results that they want. And then five would be total engagement. You have moderate to low burnout overall, and this is really the target there. You want to manage it. Sometimes it's going to be going up, but on average you want that at least moderate to low scores there. And what that actually looks like, if you're feeling the symptoms of burnout, if you're feeling particularly exhausted a few times a month or less, you're doing pretty good. It's usually at that few times a month, going into once a week, where you should be really starting to see warning signals and checking in with your team or checking with your manager for that support. So again, something to just be really mindful of and just something to keep in the back of your mind, especially for those clear-cut signs that someone may have a little bit too much on their plate, especially if they're saying, hey, I'm thinking about work all the time, or I'm thinking about work at least one night a week. They're not switching off at least once a week. That is definitely a clear-cut sign. Next slide. Two, determine disparities between groups across factors. Look at inequities between demographics. Really quickly, this is really where you are going to find where to intervene, is what are the differences between what is normal or the benchmark experience or the average experience, or those who do not identify as underrepresented in the mining industry or in your organization, relative to the folks who do identify as underrepresented in one way, shape, or form. What is that disparity, and what factors, whether it's in the areas of work life or engagement or in general burnout, that might be different? And that allows you to really hone in on what might be those really highly leverageable opportunities to make a difference, to reduce burnout in those populations that may be prone to it. Next slide. Anchor your results to KPIs. I think Jackie did a great job really giving a lot of great examples of, you know, what do you look at? What are those firm measurements? You can look at turnover, you can look at reports of harassment and things of that nature that can contribute to a burnout or be signs and indicators of burnout, to see if they're moving in tandem. But ultimately, you want to look at things like employee net promoter score, you can look at, or the intent to stay at your company. When you're looking at people who have high net promoter scores or are having a great intent to stay with your company, and looking at those who have low ratings, what are those differences and what are those opportunities that really seem to matter or be very different from the healthy scores? Additionally, how you split up your identifier groups, those individuals who self-identify some information about their demographic or who they might be in the organization, how you split that up is going to be key in terms of where do you start looking. Is it new employees? Is it particular demographics, particular genders or sexual orientations that are pretty particularly prone to this? If you're a smaller organization, you're going to want to use more more umbrella terms. For us, we are a small company, so we use, do you believe if that you are underrepresented in mining in general, as a general umbrella term, because we can't get granular without people really self-identifying too much. So we find it's a decent balance, but something that we're always looking to improve. But next slide. And then lastly, qualitative feedback. Ultimately, like Jackie said, you have employee resource groups. They're a great resource to break down these results, what might be contributing to them that may matter to them as well that they want to address. Additionally, you can use general focus groups, or you can break it down by department as well and making your managers accountable for working what you want to improve as a team and as a manager as well. Ultimately, you want to hold people, leaders of these groups, to be accountable for agreed upon change. This certainly does need to come from the top, but ultimately your people leaders are going to be the ones responsible for it on a day-to-day basis and are going to be really the big change makers on the day-to-day. Next slide. And lastly, so just some tips and tricks to leave off here. Like Jackie said, it really does start off with the communication and the trust elements, specifically certainly the why, but really having that trust, especially when it comes to burnout. These are heavy hitting questions. You're asking questions like, how often are you unenthusiastic about work? How often are you burnt out at work? How often does work take you away from things that you care about? These are hard hitting and sometimes embarrassing questions to get the results of, especially if you take a lot of pride and you don't get the results that you're looking for. These can be really difficult. And so if you're going to do it, you have to really want it. And additionally, because you're asking people to be vulnerable, giving this information, you have to have their trust first and foremost. And this is why Jackie also says, you know, start small, start somewhere to really build up that trust first and foremost. You can start with that Gallup Q12 or basic engagement survey that's positively framed to really show that you care about your employees' feedback and you are getting change done according to their feedback and the way that they're seeing it. This is also where communication comes in. People want to know what you're doing with the information and why. Why are you asking these questions and really understanding, you know, why these and not something else? What is the purpose here? You know, when are people going to be hearing back about it? Where are they going to be hearing back? What information are they getting back from us? Where are you going to be using it for again? And then additionally, how is this information being used and how is it not being used? To the privacy element, you want to make sure you're disclosing what are you not going to be using it for? What are you going to be using it for to ensure that trust? And it's not going to be used against them, especially when these questions are asking them to be vulnerable as well. So you really have to be clear. And what are those air barriers between those results and the rest of management so people can't really be singled out, worst case? So what are those protocols? And then certainly who's going to be managing this information as well. So really, you can't give enough information, and having posters, really having openly transparent communication is key, and making sure that's included in some of your materials, your posters, your frequent check-ins to make sure people understand what they're getting into and what they need to know. Knowing the measures used and knowing what you are asking is so key. Like I said, burnout asks some heavy hitting questions and can get you into some trouble with how you interpret it. You don't want to look at just exhaustion and say, we're burnt out. You want to look at that entire measure there and say, look at a whole picture. Hey, we are overextended, but we're doing okay when it comes to cynicism or inefficacy. And we're looking at jobs and demands and resources as a way to mitigate. And that way you're not overgeneralizing it. You're not creating a panic, but you're calling it what it is. And really, where are those interventions and or where are you aiming it as well? And how is it affecting different populations, especially when you're going into psychological instruments? They're not all built the same. Some of them can be more racialized and gendered. Some of them can not get the same results that you're looking for. Thankfully, burnout MBI, it does connect very, very well. It is very impartial, but it does get into what are perhaps some of those underlying factors of differential experiences. Then lastly, forms of work groups are really important to get that qualitative feedback and to have that discussion. These are just numbers to rigid questions at the end of the day, and you want to have that context to be able to create an action plan with your employees and your managers to move these things forward in ways that matter to employees, to show them that you're listening and that fuels that trust moving forward. And lastly, data collection and who can use it best for DEI. Data collection in general, you want to make sure that you're being respectful of diversity, how you're asking those questions, making sure people are being heard, not being othered, and asking and consulting your employees with how they feel about answering that question is always a good way forward as well if you're not sure where to start. But I know that Leslie has some resources for that as well to help you along your way. Additionally, having that privacy disclaimer is so key as well in terms of what you're using it for, what you're not using it for, and making sure people are consenting to the use of this information, as well as being aware of how that self-identifying information is being used and knowing that it is voluntary, that they do not have to self-identify. You want to make sure people are comfortable at the end of the day providing their information. And at the end of the day, you want them to provide honest information and not that having that self-identifying information get in the way. The more that people trust you, in my experience, the more that they are willing to provide that information. And then lastly, I'll leave you with this. Beware of averages. People, to reference Todd Rose, people are not average. People are jagged. They are not a steady line. They are the outliers. They are the in-betweens, and they're everything. So please do not pigeonhole any one individual. These averages, again, are just indicators, especially when you may not be able to put everyone under the microscope. It just helps you understand where you should be looking to ask further questions through those forums and work groups to find identifiable ways forward. So that's it for me, everyone. I hope you got something out of it. But if you have any questions, certainly my information is available if anyone wants to have a follow-up. But thanks so much.
Thank you very much, Dan. Great presentation. Our final speaker is Leslie Wolcott. I'm pleased to introduce her as the strategic corporate leader with extensive human resources management, adult education, and stakeholder engagement experience. She has spearheaded large-scale cultural change and capacity-building programs focused on equity, diversity, inclusion, workplace harassment, and violence in the education and community sectors. Using collaborative, multifaceted strategies, Leslie supports diversity and inclusion efforts at unique sites among diverse stakeholders and within the sector generally. Over to Leslie, please.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Shirley. And thanks, Jackie and Dan, for such great, thoughtful presentations. There's lots for us to digest and to kind of pull the different threads together. So without further ado, I'll jump into the piece on EDI data and objectives. But I will say that I'm joining today from the traditional Mijisagig Anishinaabeg territory, the land associated with the Williams Treaty of 1923 and Rice Lake Treaty Number 20 of 1818. My presence here in Nogojiwinang or Peterborough connects me to Curve Lake First Nation, Alderville First Nation, Hiawatha First Nation, and the Mississaugas of Scugog Island First Nation. And I'll also recognize the growing number of urban First Nations, Métis, and even Inuit here in the Peterborough area, owing to our Indigenous Studies programs at Trent University. So we're excited about these demographics in the local area. I wanted to just help tie some of our pieces together by talking about the TSM EDI Workplaces Protocol and this Indicator 3. Reminder that it links, there's also a link to the Safe, Healthy, and Respectful Workplaces Protocol and also to the TSM Protocol on Indigenous and Community Relations. And as we talked about earlier, there's a significant piece here in addressing, when we look at Indicator 3, in addressing both that quantitative and the qualitative elements of data. So on to the next slide. This indicator 3 focuses on monitoring performance and reporting, particularly at the facility level. that may be aligned with your corporate strategy, as we saw in indicator two, but we're looking at these indicators by facility. And since joining MIR, I've consistently heard within the sector the mantra that what gets measured gets done, and we're challenged to think about how we get at not just move beyond the discussion about representation and objectives that are focused on what the kind of talent pool looks like, to getting at these things that that may be other indicators, such as what Jackie and Dan shared today. So indicator three, its objective is to confirm that the facility engages to develop an approach to information gathering and reporting on equitable, diverse, and inclusive workplaces. So clearly moving beyond just that kind of targeted demographic piece. The trick, if you will, or the truth of gathering EDI-related information is that the process itself can serve as a means of engagement with the opportunity to build confidence in the data gathering processes, and in turn supporting better data and enhanced engagement in the information gathering process. I'll say that of the three indicators and their implementation, feel welcome to drop into the chat indicating which of the three indicators, the one focused more on the corporate, the one focused more on the facility and the workplace cultures piece, or this indicator focusing on data, which one you feel you need the most help with moving on from here. And with that, I'll move on to just a key into I didn't change that title. It should be indicator three. But the elements that are in indicator three are the demographic data collection, and I'll speak to that in a moment. That you define or set out the scope for your data collection. So that gets a little bit at what Jackie and Dan were talking about in terms of clarifying what your needs are and working in line with that need, and also how you're going to do it. Developing an action plan to that end, but very importantly, that work is informed by engagement and collaboration with people with diverse perspectives and diverse stakeholders in the workplace. And that is key. That also within indicator three, there are elements of public reporting, monitoring, and analysis. There is a requirement to have to see to the effectiveness of your data gathering processes, but also communications. As I mentioned, it gets at qualitative and or quantitative information being reported. It talks about ensuring the indicator points to ensuring that performance objectives are established, they're aligned, and you're reporting on progress of those performance objectives that you've set out. And then it sets out at the higher AAA level, it sets out a public reporting on your process. And at an earlier level, I think it's AA, it sets out an internal reporting on your progress. So those are the key elements contained within indicator three. Again, my apologies that that slide hasn't, I didn't change that title on that slide, but moving on to the next section that I just want to share a little bit of information on. This piece of gathering demographic data is a more sensitive matter. And it's something that all people who are gathering and organizations who are gathering demographic data grapple with. Statistics Canada grapples with it. University researchers struggle with it. Organizations struggle with it. So part of the toolkit that I've been speaking about will feature a sample that we used earlier last year, a sample of some questions that you can adapt or use for your use. And I'll run through some of those in the next, beginning on the next slide. So in our demographic questionnaire that we used, we got at elements of age, gender identity, sexual orientation, a number of additional identity factors, which I'll speak to, using a long and a short form. Because we were undertaking national work, we asked about location, and we asked about level of education, which is also a very sensitive question, and I'll speak a little bit to how we try to address that in as inclusive a way as possible. I'll run through those pieces, but I do also want to share, just on the next slide, you'll recall that the piece that we've been talking throughout these webinar sessions about the training modules that MIR has planned and is going to be launching two new modules or training programs in the next few weeks, in addition to our existing Indigenous awareness and intercultural awareness. The reason I have identified them on this slide, and they relate to subsequent slides, is that through these training programs, we also provide more information about these different facets of diversity and have worked concertedly through those training programs to help clarify or raise awareness around different terms, most current terms, how they relate to one another, sometimes how they're complementary, how they're different, and so on. So you'll find that the training sessions are very helpful for these questions of identifiers as well. So with regard to gender identity, we wanted to, in our questionnaire, move beyond the binary of asking simply about male and female gender identity. And so we include the option to indicate if somebody identifies as transgender, as non-binary, as Two-Spirit, which is relevant to First Nations, Métis, and Inuit communities in particular, I think more specifically to First Nations and Métis communities. And then also importantly, always offer people, respondents, and an opportunity to self-identify. So we would have a check, a box there where someone can indicate prefer to self-identify, and then a text box where they can indicate particular language or terms that they use to identify. And then also very important to offer the opportunity to prefer not to answer on any particular question. So this piece gets at how someone identifies in terms of gender identity. Moving to the next slide, we also provide some examples of how to get at sexual orientation. So sexual orientation gets at feelings of attraction and who you're attracted to. So the language we used and offer in the sample template is the language around being straight or heterosexual, identifying as gay, identifying as lesbian, as queer, as bisexual, as Two-Spirit. Also, as mentioned, offering the opportunity to self-identify or prefer not to answer. This recognizes that there's a fair bit of there's quite a range of language and terms that are used to identify one's sexual orientation. We offer the opportunity to use additional terms, but we've highlighted here, I think, what the key ones are that will help organizations get started in this area if they're not already gathering this information. And also, as Dan and Jackie spoke about, beginning and building trust, because these are very sensitive identifiers, as people will appreciate. Next slide. So there are a host of additional identity factors that one could, an organization could ask about. And so this circle, I'm not going to go into the circle, but the circle really, I included it just to identify the range of possible other identifiers. And so in the template that you'll see, we pose questions that get at disability. When we approached this, we focused in on learning disabilities, physical disabilities, and or mental health related disabilities. One may go much more extent, an organization may choose to go much more extensively than that, but I think that's a reasonable starting point. And then recall again that a participant in it who's providing this information or responding to this self-identification can also add other identifiers that may suit them in that preferred to self-identify piece. Then we also include questions around indigeneity. There are a number of ways to do that. Increasingly, it's my understanding that it's better, and I think you'll get more authentic information if when I asking to, you could inquire first into indigeneity, and then if an individual chooses that box, they may indicate providing the option to indicate First Nation, Métis, and or Inuit, Inuk, and or one may bypass that indigeneity and offer simply those three options, First Nation, Métis, and Inuit. And in fact, some also may wish to identify their particular band or community, which they can also do through prefer to self-identify. Another very sensitive piece is getting at membership in a group that's racialized. And sometimes you'll see the phrase visible minority. Now, this is a phrase that comes out of the federal employment equity legislation. It is a problematic phrase that the federal government is looking to address, but because of that legislation and that continued use of that term at this time, we would suggest using that, and or I believe on our format we said member of a racialized group / visible minority. And we've got some language that I think that I'll share around that. The other is to differentiate that from ethnicity, which is, getting at if someone identifies as Anglo-Celtic, or if someone identifies as Scottish, or someone identifies as Togolese or Senegalese, or, a member of an ethnic group within any particular country or nation. And so that tends to be a much longer list and can be much more complex. And I think really this is where it gets back into identifying exactly what you're gathering the data for. And I think often in our purposes, we're trying to understand systemic barriers that are rooted, tend to be more rooted in racialization and the challenges associated with racialization. The other piece that we draw out is getting at an individual's immigrating experience. And so can also be significant in the workplace for any number of reasons. So these are the factors that we get at in addition to the gender identity and the sexual orientation factors when we're trying to gather, some demographic data. And I'll just go to the next slide, if we could. I mentioned location. That was fairly straightforward for us. We worked by province there. You may have another approach depending on your organization, but also level of education, we wanted to understand and provide some guidance with regard to gathering information about education. This can be very sensitive information. We try to use as inclusive an approach as possible. We included language for enabling respondents to indicate other, please identify. So if we missed something, somebody can add to that, and then also prefer not to answer. But in trying to set out as inclusive a format as possible around this, we included possible responses that got at not only completion of, you know, particular certification or degrees or diploma, but if someone had engaged with a particular program and could point to that experience also, and that experience could also be valued and represented in different responses around level of education. So you'll see in our toolkit this sample demographic data, but I did want to walk through that a little bit today. I'm going on a little bit, so I'll move on to the next slide, please, Mary Lou, and then quickly on to the next one. I only have a couple of more slides. Folks will recall, I'm hopeful I haven't been too repetitive, but they say that it's best to put information before people 7 times. So I'm working a little bit on that theory, but MIR is producing this toolkit of resources to help with the implementation of the TSM protocols. We've got guides, we've got tip sheets, we've got infographics and templates and a matrix that will give you a bit of a key to how all of the tools fit together and support you to implement the different TSM indicators. And then to the next slide, as I've mentioned, that the toolkit pairs with these training programs that I've mentioned and will also pair with our online ensemble network, which is being renewed and refreshed, as well as EDI web pages that will have, and it'll offer you users a really comprehensive package of resources and materials that can help you move through implementation. And then the last slide that I have is really just highlighting with regard to indicator 3, we focus in on some key guides and infographics that are focused on monitoring and reporting EDI performance. That engagement piece, offering guidance with regard to community identity and collaboration, and working in collaboration with Indigenous communities to work out a way of validating community identity. There's also some pieces relevant to the corporate EDI strategy that fall into this piece because we're coming up with objectives and goals. There are tip sheets about engagement here in terms of ensuring robust questions are being asked in appropriate ways that are relevant to the communities that are going to be responding to the surveys and requests for information. And we're offering a fair bit of guidance around gathering and managing sensitive information. And that has to do with getting informed consent, provides guidance on storage and handling material information to make sure that those tenets and principles around voluntary, confidential information is maintained and that informed consent is provided. And lastly, as I mentioned, we've got that sample demographic questionnaire. Those are the pieces I really want to highlight and draw to your attention. And I think, Mary Lou's just on that last slide. So I just really want to highlight those pieces. And I think that's it for me. And thank you to everyone. I'll just hand it back to you, Shirley.
Thanks so much, Leslie. We will now, as I mentioned, start the Q&A portion of this session. I did note that there is one, I believe, question so far in the chat. Dan hit on something that resonated, the vulnerability of receiving these results. Sometimes this feeling stifles actioning the data. How can we support leaders to action the results when it feels daunting?
Yeah, any thoughts, Dan? Old question, taking accountability. I think like Jackie said as well, it all starts with why. You know, you have to understand, and I think we all can, I think we can all empathize. Work often is not great for pretty much anyone, no matter who you are, some more than others for sure, and some companies more than others, especially when you look at, you know, global engagement data like Gallup. You know, I think it's like 19% of workforces are engaged or actively engaged. And so, you know, we have to admit, first and foremost, work has never been and continues to be not the greatest place for people to really flourish. And there's a lot of opportunity here. And it really starts with asking the hard questions. You know, the one thing that always piqued my interest was, you know, yes, engagement is great, knowing what energizes, but they're always positively framed questions. What is that other side of that equation? And, you know, I don't think it was popularized because they are very hard questions. But again, when you're looking at those intangible barriers, you have to ask those hard questions as to what might be causing it. And so I think, again, when you're framing it, it is really looking in real terms is who does work for, and, you know, what are those real indicators? And there's a lot of research around burnout that really links the two. And so really starting with that, I think is really a big one. And I think just being honest with ourselves, because I don't think you're fooling anybody that, you know, all organizations are great all the time. So yeah, just starting with that honesty.
Excellent point, Dan. That's all the question and how it's framed is the proper starting point, I think, is what I just heard there. Thank you so much for that response. I'll invite the participants to post any questions that they may have in the chat. But as we were going through the present, in the absence of any others at this point, I jotted down a couple while people were making their presentations. So I'll start with Jackie. Jackie, how long did it take, or has it taken so far, as the case may be, to gain that trust that you were speaking of?
I would say it's a great question, Shirley. We're not there yet. We've been at it for 2 years. And I'd say we see progress, right? So each year, like, you see an increase in existing employees going in and switching, you know, mm-hmm. their selections for their demographic information. And what we've decided to do is really strengthen our communication, right? Okay. And help build that trust and the transparency. And, you know, we asked for this and it's resulted in this, like, very crystal clear, so that there's that understanding of why. So yeah, it's still in progress. You know, I think it's going to take a multifaceted approach, right? I think we're going to have to prove a little bit in our doing. Not just, you know, yeah, here's why we're doing it, it's great for you, but really showing this is the result or the outcome yeah. of what you told us, right? Same goes to our listening strategy for the qualitative stuff.
Yeah, no, excellent points, I think, and communication is key, I think, is the if I had to summarize that response.
Yeah, yeah. Seven times, right, Leslie?
Right on. And I'll stick with you, Jackie, for a moment. Have you noted an uptick in the local Indigenous applicants and or promotions? I think that was one of the indicators you mentioned.
Yeah. Yes, we have in certain regions with very purposeful outreach and very purposeful recruitment campaigns. Yeah.
Excellent. Good to hear that you're having some early success then. And still, as you pointed out, early in your program. Awesome. Thank you so much. Dan, your slides, you talked about the differences in the percentages of people who often or always feel burnt out pre and post COVID. That number I noted seemed like it was pretty high already. Even before the increased pressures that we've all experienced as we experienced this thing called COVID. My question though is how do you prevent burnout for those who are trying to address burnout by others?
So are you speaking towards more like a compassion fatigue or something along those lines?
No, I think your slides talked about, you know, that's an indicator that you might want to act upon. So if you're the one trying to prevent that burnout, how do you prevent the burnout from impacting you yourself, you know, in this overwhelming space potentially?
Absolutely. Always a hard one, especially for myself. I feel like I'm undisciplined really at the end of the day, but I think it's really living with a particular level of purpose with where you get your energy, how you recharge, and really understanding, especially as you get older, there is that health component, and it becomes so much more noticeable as well. So really taking care of yourself. But especially during the pandemic for myself, I had a personal journey where, you know, you really had to learn that, you know, the way forward is collectivism. You know, you're not going to be accomplishing anything by yourself. That's a way towards madness. And I think having that level of detachment, that's not all on you. This is about a community sort of level effort, that you're doing this together, and don't putting that responsibility on yourself. Really understanding that, I think, goes a long way, especially when I think people want to see so much change now, and change always happens more slowly than we want it to. So it's very easy to really burn out that way. So I think really seeing the big picture and not going through it by yourself as well, because that's a way towards madness. And beyond that, celebrate your wins. It's really easy to lose sight any sort of progress, but you have to celebrate the little wins. Even every little rollout, every little tick upwards is a win. Even just a single individual that's reporting healthy scores, that's perfect. You know, that's a life change right there. And that's really what it's about. You know, it's about progress, not perfection. And Lord knows the journey is going to be long as well.
Excellent points there, Dan. Thank you. I think, don't be a hero and lean on your community, whatever that community may be. I think is how I would summarize what you just responded there. Thank you so much, Dan. Leslie, regarding the question, I think was on one of your last slides about whether you're currently pursuing training or education as the list of your education levels. The thing that occurred to me on that question was, are you getting at, are they a student? Or are they like me, who views themselves as a lifelong learner and always embraces the opportunity to learn something new or something else, perhaps?
Yeah. So that goes with that really inclusive approach to that piece. So again, offering people the opportunity to say, no, this is also how I see this or engage with this. And I think there's also a space there to indicate other training or certifications. I can't remember exactly the language, but you know, I think it's really important to recognize what, you know, some identify as formal and informal, you know, for lack of better phraseology, learning, and enabling people to get at that lifelong learning that they're also engaging with. It's helpful to know. You know, it's helpful to know those pieces, because you may have someone with expertise in your organization that you really can draw on in some way also, you know, or you're happy to know that that exists within your organization, even if you don't, in honoring the confidentiality, you don't pull that out, but you know, oh, it is here within our organization.
Right. So really it's that inclusiveness that you guys try to embrace as you came up with the survey questions.
Yes. I'll just share. Sorry, I forgot to mention that sample template was reviewed by members of our Inclusion and Diversity Standing Committee, and also that there was feedback from other subject matter experts providing input into those, how we get at some of those indicators.
Excellent.
Yeah. There's a question that came in. It says, it's for Jackie. How is self-identification measured for participation rate when it's voluntary and completion can be on a spectrum, employees complete section 1 to 5?
So if I understand the question correctly, it's saying, you know, how do you measure your success when we know it's voluntary, right? So it's up to people to voluntarily disclose data. And I guess that's the gist of the question. And so what I would say is, and I started at the beginning of the presentation, it's directional. And I think Dan said it, right? Don't get caught in percentages. Don't get caught in, you know, this is just what it is, right? That number. You have to look at it and say, okay, directionally, are we seeing an increase, decrease? How do we have enough programmatic things to create trust and confidentiality? Do we need to explain more around what we're doing, when, how we're collecting the data, what it's for, and where it's used? And so it's a piece of the puzzle, right? It's not the entire thing. And it's not to say, because you also, if you look at underrepresented groups within the industry and within the organization, the percentages are going to be much different, right? They're going to be a lot smaller, especially in the beginning. And we can't ignore that. But if we were to take a position of, well, we're going to go with the largest percentage group, right? That's going to make the most engagement. That's going to create the most loyalty within the organization. That's a flawed assumption, because your base is not the same. And so you have to look at it as a piece of the data that you have. And then, you know, you can look and see, are you seeing an increase, right? Because you can look at it statistically and say, you know, we know that there is more. And so how do we get to a place where people feel comfortable telling us about their identity? Hopefully that answers the question.
Yes, they said thank you.
Awesome.
Do you see any others, Mary Lou?
No, that's it. There's nothing that came in directly to the CIM National.
Okay. Well, I would like to once again thank all of our panelists for their wonderful wisdom sharing that they've given us all today. I believe each would be welcome to receiving follow-up questions directly, should you be so inclined. And perhaps I will just remind everyone that the next session planned for this series is in 2 weeks' time. It will be on psychological safety and respectful behavior, occurring on Wednesday, March 27th, at the same time, 11:30 till 1 o'clock Eastern. So thanks again, everyone, for your participation and attention today. Have a great rest of your day.
Thank you, everyone. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Thanks, everyone. Charlie.